empty dice machine. Thank you. We have a silk bar.
I have to get my body acclimated to this. I just saw three blocks of ice floating around you as I read it. Eddie told me the truth. Is about like the polar bear thing at Myrtle Beach.
You can help me.
We'll get serious in a moment. This is a serious moment. Okay, Ken enjoying. That top step's a little slippery, so go. Ken, if you come on down at the same time. Y'all know I told you the truth, don't you? This will be one baptismal service nobody will ever forget. I won't, that's for sure. Obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Upon your profession of faith, children, I baptize you today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you, Ken, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
If I go too far down, I'm sure.
I got you. Take that hand. Special.
Like that.
It's a special blessing today to baptize this dear lady. It's Eileen, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus, today I baptize you. Amen. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus and obedience to His command, I baptize you, Eddie, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Wonderful name, faith in hope. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus, obedience to His command, I baptize you today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Danielle, in obedience to the command of Jesus and in the profession of your faith in Christ, gives me joy to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we recognize this morning there's absolutely no salvation in these waters. This is but a beautiful picture of what has already taken place in these individuals' lives. Acknowledge one day they were sinners in need of a Savior. Could not save themselves. So they came in faith to the Lord Jesus, invited Him into their lives to become their Lord as well as their Savior. And so this is but a picture of that burial of old life and resurrection to the new life. Their faith in Christ and their obedience to his command, we baptize them today. But Father, this is but day one. There are many days left. And so I pray, Father, this will be a day they shall not forget. They'll remember this day, as did the lady the other evening in the restroom. Lord, I pray they'll grow in grace and knowledge of Jesus. Help us, help me as a pastor here. Help the deacons, help the congregation to realize that we have an awesome responsibility to these newborn children in Christ, to help them to grow. And I pray that you will enable us to do that. And I pray it in Jesus' name.
Yeah. come together, it's not the Lord's Supper you eat. For as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anybody else. One remains hungry and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and you humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not. For I received from the Lord what I also passed.
Is it on?
Yes.
Can you hear now?
Yes.
Well, seriously, there are scores of people who, and you know, I reckon because I've been in church all my life, I really don't understand why people just are turned off by the church. I really can't understand that. Mom and I talk oftentimes that we couldn't survive without you. And I've heard many of you say in times of crisis, I couldn't survive without my church family. It's so wonderful to have a church family that cares. So we're going to show our caring in another way for a few minutes this morning. How would you and Nancy come up? How would Nancy have a granddaughter, Ellie, who has really, she's 12 years of age, and Ellie has been through a whole lot. She's going through a lot of problems now. And Howard talked with me at length last week about Ellie. And I want us to have a special prayer for her. Randy, if you and the deacons will come, and they stand in behalf of their granddaughter. And then others of you who wish to pray, I know that many of you have burdens, you please come down to the altar and join with us, but I want us to particularly focus on Howard and Nancy's granddaughter, Ellie. I remember, Father, growing up in my church, that we often sang, "Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near." Now that you know it, sing it with me. Because as we come into the Lord's table and the Lord's Supper, depicting the cross of Christ, and that little chorus is so true. So sing it with me. "Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is really God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me." God answers prayer. God
answers prayer.
God answers prayer. Father, I can understand very much so the pain of Howard and Nancy this morning. Grandson sitting in this congregation this morning. I don't know how my heart aches for them sometimes. I know how much I want to see them prospering, be blessed of God. Little Ellie's been through a great deal in the last couple of years, really. A lot of trauma, a lot of emotional trauma. These grandparents have been through that with her, Father, because we walk through those valleys with our children and our grandchildren. And so I want to pray for Howard and Nancy today that they're such wonderful Christians, love you. And Ellie's one of your children, likewise. I pray for her mom, particularly also, who's been through this with her. Now, Lord, as doctors trying to find how they can best treat her, I pray you'd give those doctors wisdom. Lord, there's so many blessings that we've received this week. Thank you that Gail has been able to return this morning after a period of illness. I pray for Joe this morning that he continues to recover from his surgery, and I pray that not only physical but spiritual blessings would rest upon him and Tammy. Thank you for these candidates that we have had the privilege to baptize this morning. Now, Lord, as we observe this, it represents broken body and shed blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for this church that believes in the gospel and preaches the gospel and teaches the gospel and lives the gospel. And I pray, Father, what we have witnessed here this morning would be just one of many times during this church year that we'll be able to stir those waters of baptism, seeing people come to faith and trust in Jesus, and then that you'd help us to nurture them in the ways of the Lord. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Y'all just go ahead and leave. It is said that on the night before our Lord was crucified, at the conclusion of the feast of the Passover, which he and his disciples were celebrating, it said that Jesus took bread and he blessed that bread and said, "This is my body, which is given for you." On the same night, he took the cup. And Jesus declared that this represents my blood, which will be shed for you. Again, there's no magic in this, in these elements. There's no magic in the waters of baptism. But they represent something very, very special. More than anything else, they represent the cross of Christ. They represent the blood of Jesus. I carry, hope I put it in my pocket this morning. Changing pants, I may not have, but I carry in my pocket, I found it. I carry in my pocket a little cross. It just represents the most important thing in the world to me, and that's Jesus and his death on the cross. And every time I reach in my pocket for something, my hands normally will touch that cross. I've been carrying this one for a long time, one of the ones I picked up in Jerusalem. Randy, if you'll come in. Denise has so beautifully played, "For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And this represents the bruised, broken body of the Lord Jesus that he gave up for us. Father, it is with the deepest sense of gratitude that as believers in Christ, we express our gratitude this morning, our love to you, for your willingness to give your body, broken and bruised as it was on Calvary, for our sins. Not for ours only, Father, but help us today to realize for the sins of all the world, and help us be more earnest and faithful in sharing that message of good news to our family, to our neighbors, to those we rub shoulders with on a day-by-day basis. In Jesus' name, amen. Said that on the same night our Lord took the cup, having blessed it, gave to his disciples. "This is my blood which is shed for you." According to the law, I can say all things are cleansed by blood, and apart from the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanseth us from all sin. We sing it sometimes, Father. So true to the gospel, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Father, again this morning, as we gave you thanks for your body, we give you thanks for the shedding of your blood on Calvary. And I'm so thankful for what another great song that we sing. The blood will never lose its power. Until Jesus comes back, the blood of Jesus will continue to cleanse men from their sins. In fact, one of the things that you said to us in your word is that we're to do this. We're to have this observance in anticipation of your returning to earth. In Jesus' name. I had said last Sunday I was going to speak this morning on the subject of where are we and where am I. And when I realized that with baptism and the Lord's Supper, I would not have adequate time to do that. Greg's going to come and preach this morning, and I don't have a watch I can watch him because it's laying up here on the baptistry. Come on, Greg. And I'll tell you when Greg's finished why I asked him to do this.
Always.
this white noise that we think about, this white noise of secularism, it has a big impact on the church, too. You ever notice that, like, when the service starts, it's Ray's turn to get up, and he just sits here and doesn't say anything? It almost reaches a point where it gets awkward, because we're always used to something going on. You know, we've got to have something going on the screen behind us. We have to have music playing. We have to have somebody talking the whole time. Or, you know, we're singing or we're doing this. But if it's just that silence with nothing going on, it's like, you get antsy almost. And silence and meditation used to be a way to listen to God and speak with God. And sometimes silence, and we'll come to this in a second, but sometimes silence can help us get in touch with that which is sacred. And here are a couple of examples from the Bible. You know, the Hebrews referred to God as Yahweh. And yet it was the name that they could not even say. They could not even mention his name because he was so holy and sacred. So it was a name that couldn't even be spoken. So, you know, think about that idea of silence and sacredness. And you can't even say God's name. So you just keep quiet. Jesus wandered in the wilderness for 40 days. Now, of course, he was tempted by Satan, but there wasn't a whole lot of conversation going on there with other people because he was by himself. So that was 40 days of silence. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, you know, the disciples, y'all watch over you while I pray. So praying, we don't know if he was praying silently or he was actually speaking. It was a time of silence in one way or another as he prepared to walk together. And even the Sabbath, God set aside the Sabbath day as something separate from all those distractions that we deal with today. So, the point of what this article that I got this information from, are these distractions, are they a threat to the way we worship? Because we've got all this stuff going around us, and we actually encourage it in church, so we can be like everybody else and get people to come in. But does that really keep us sometimes from worship?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it does or not, but it's certainly something to consider.
You through? Okay. I'm very serious for a moment. What Greg shared in the deacons' meeting last Sunday morning affected me greatly. I was used to using my smartphone all the time. Not as used to being busy all the time, as most of us are. This past week, I began to spend some time every day. God's provided us, and I've told you this before, but God recently provided Mom and I just an awesome place to live. And we have a porch. It's the only house, I think, in the neighborhood that has a porch like we have it. It's sort of, we're protected from the public. And I've been going out there, Greg, every day, sometime very early in the morning, sometime very, very late at night. Just sit there. Just think. Awesomeness of God. Quote scripture, sing songs. What I'm doing is this, asking you. It will make a great difference in your life if you'll take some time every single day just to get along with God. Scripture says, be still and know that I'm God. How long since you've done that? There's a word in the book of Psalms that's often used, Selah. Selah, however you want to pronounce it, S-E-L-A-H. You know what that means? Stop and think about what you've read. So oftentimes we even read scripture and don't stop to think about what we've read. We read a few verses and we close the Bible up and we go our way. I'm challenging you every one of you, to take some time. It will make a difference in your life. You know what else it'll do? Make a difference in the life of this church. Just pause. Think about the goodness, the greatness, the awesomeness of our great God. I'm going to ask these six that we baptized this morning, come stand down front. Would you please come stand here? After Greg leads us in our closing song, I want you to come down, face the congregation. I'm presenting to these teenagers this morning a Bible from the church. It's my favorite translation today. If I give you the wrong one, it's written in it. If I give you the wrong one, you girls can straighten it out. Okay? Okay. Let's pray again. And then Greg's going to lead us in singing. Then you come by and just rejoice with these dear people. Father, it's been a good day. Help me this week to spend that time. Just get along with you. Meditate on your awesomeness, your splendor, your glory, your might. Help me to do that. I pray, Father, these six precious souls that have been baptized this morning, partaking of the Lord's Supper, God, remind them every single day they're your children. You love them. You've got a purpose, a plan for each one of their lives. Help them to live that out and help this church, this pastor, to not forsake them in the process of growing in the grace and knowledge of Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.